Greetings. Thank you, Abdul, for your question. Why does the Bible contradict itself in Proverbs 31:6-7 and 1 Corinthians 6:10? I believe you are sincere, brother, and God honors our sincere desire to learn. In Proverbs 4:5 it says, "Acquire wisdom, acquire understanding. Do not forget nor turn away from the words of my mouth." This is King Solomon, Prophet Solomon, teaching his wisdom. Proverbs 4:7, "The beginning of wisdom is this, get wisdom, and whatever you get insight," meaning understanding. I just love that. Here is the first piece of wisdom you need. Ready? You'll want to remember this. Write it down. Get wisdom.
Do I need to explain it to you, Lucy, one more time?
Proverbs 23:23. Buy truth and do not sell it. Get wisdom and instruction and understanding. So knowledge, understanding, and wisdom are highly prized according to the Word of God. In fact, God has some harsh things to say about rejecting knowledge. Hosea 4:6, "My people are destroyed for lack of knowledge. Because you have rejected knowledge, I will reject you from being a priest to me. And since you have forgotten the law of your God, I also will forget your children." Let us take a look together at these two verses you cite and better understand what they say and why they say it. You have mentioned Proverbs 31, verse 6 and 7, and 1 Corinthians 6:10. Proverbs 31:6, "Give strong drink unto him that is ready to perish, and wine unto those that be of heavy hearts." Now, when you take this out of context, you might mistake this as God commanding strong drink. That is why gathering understanding requires reading the context. This is truth whether you read the Bible or the Quran or any other book. So what is the context of this text, this teaching? Proverbs 31:1, "The sayings of King Lemuel, an inspired utterance his mother taught him." Right away we see this is Prophet Solomon recording words of another king. This is wisdom, but not presented as, "Thus says the Lord God." Listen, my son. Listen, son of my womb. Listen, my son, the answer of my prayers. Do not give your strength to women or your ways to that which destroys kings. It is not for kings, O Lemuel. It is not for kings to drink wine, nor for princes strong drink. Drinking, strong drink, and authority are not a good combination. But don't take my word for it. Here is why. Proverbs 31:5. "Otherwise he," meaning the king, "will drink, forget what is decreed, and pervert justice for all the oppressed. Give strong drink to him who is perishing, and wine to him whose life is bitter." One who is perishing means they are dying. Alcohol has long been used as an anesthetic. It dulls the senses, which decreases the sensation of pain and suffering. And in context here, it is speaking of one who is perishing, meaning dying. Give strong drink to him who is perishing, and wine to him whose life is bitter. It is also speaking of one whose life is bitter. Many things are bitter. Having a child die is bitter. Having an illness that leads to the death of a loved one is bitter. For those suffering a time of bitterness, wine can help ease the bitterness. Let him drink and forget his poverty and remember his misery no more. So what are we to learn from this passage? At times, such as poverty, loss, or suffering, there is wisdom to having some wine to temporarily ease the suffering. And for those on their deathbed, stronger drink can act as an anesthetic to decrease their suffering. These are not instructions to drink and whore and be a drunken, vomiting fool. There is neither excuse or approval for drinking to excess as a common, typical behavior. So let us examine the other verse you have been taught is in contradiction. 1 Corinthians 6:9. This is the context. Do you not know that the wicked will not inherit the kingdom of God? Do not be deceived. Neither the sexually immoral, nor idolaters, nor adulterers, nor men who submit to or perform homosexual acts. This is quite a list of behaviors that Paul is condemning. Fornicators, idolaters, adulterers, homosexuals. Even Islam appears to condemn a few of these. But Paul is not finished yet. Context, context, context. Nor thieves, nor the greedy, nor drunkards, nor verbal abusers, nor swindlers will inherit the kingdom of God. Thieves, greedy, drunkards, revilers, meaning verbal abusers, and swindlers. And there is the word, drunkards, which Islam focuses on to claim this contradicts Proverbs. Clearly, Apostle Paul, who Islam reviles, teaches against being a drunkard. Clearly, the New Testament, which describes the New Covenant Christians have, teaches us to be holy. Matthew 5:16, in the same way, let your light shine before men, that they may see your good deeds and glorify your Father in heaven. Matthew 5:48, be perfect, therefore, as your heavenly Father is perfect. 1 Peter 2:12, conduct yourselves with such honor among the Gentiles that though they slander you as evildoers, they may see your good deeds and glorify God on the day he visits us. And this includes not being a drunkard, which means not being an out-of-control, falling-down, sloppy, vomiting drunk. This does not say to never let a drop of alcohol cross your lips, though some take it to that extreme. 2 Peter 1:3, His divine power has given us everything we need for life and godliness through the knowledge of Him who called us by His own glory and excellence. Through these, He has given us His precious and magnificent promises, so that through them you may become partakers of the divine nature, now that you have escaped the corruption in the world caused by evil desires. Our evil desires are part of the evil nature we had before we accepted Christ as Lord. But now He gives us His divine nature. This is the essence of being born again by His Holy Spirit. For this reason, make every effort to add to your faith virtue, meaning goodness, and to virtue, knowledge. You see, this holiness is what the disciples taught. They did not teach, you have forgiveness, go sin and live like the devil. And to knowledge, self-control, and to self-control, perseverance, and to perseverance, godliness. Why exert and struggle and strive to gain self-control to give it up when drunk? The accusation does not stand up against the actual teaching. And to godliness, brotherly kindness, and to brotherly kindness, love. The Greek word is agape. Agape is self-sacrificing love, unknown until God revealed Himself as agape. For God so loved, the root word is agape there, loved the world, that He gave His only begotten Son, that whoever believes in Him shall not perish, but have eternal life. 1 John 4:7, Beloved, let us love one another, for love is of God, and everyone that loves is born of God and knows God. All of these words love come from the root word agape. He that loves not, again, this root word is agape, doesn't know God. If you don't love with agape, you don't know God. For God is agape. God is love. We are to add the attributes and behaviors Peter describes. Until we add agape, we add God to our very hearts. For if you possess these qualities and continue to grow in them, they will keep you from being ineffective and unproductive in your knowledge of our Lord Jesus Christ. But whoever lacks these traits is nearsighted to the point of blindness, having forgotten that he has been cleansed from his past sins. Therefore, brothers, be all the more eager to make your calling and election sure, for if you practice these things, you will never stumble, and you will receive a lavish reception into the eternal kingdom of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. I hope you can see that drunkenness is neither encouraged or accepted as a behavior. In fact, drunkenness is no different than other behaviors, like thievery or homosexuality. There is no contradiction between this and what Prophet Solomon recorded that King Lemuel was taught by his mother. May the Spirit of God open your eyes to the light, your ears to the truth, and your heart to his Son, the Lord Jesus Christ. Amen.